thank you for coming to the screening of this beautiful print of this amazing film. And thank you for staying for the panel devoted to Hou Hsiao-hsien. We've just seen the 1986 film, Dust in the Wind. And because it's very interesting, because this is a whole film that points in two directions. It points back to the autobiographical trilogy that was Ho's first sustained contribution to the Taiwanese New Cinema. It also, in some respects, looks toward the three historical films that climax Ho's Taiwanese generation of filmmakers. A Century of Chinese Cinema visits these two trilogies in the coming weeks. On July 1st, both Time to Live, Time to Die from the first trilogy will be shown back to back with Ho's political and historical masterpiece, City of Sadness. It's my privilege today to introduce our speakers, Professors David Bordwell and James Udden. I will say a few words introducing them in just a moment. First, I would like to observe only that the three regional strands of Chinese cinema have created many films of remarkable artistic importance and historically invaluable documentation of the last century. The rich panorama of Chinese cinema assembled by the Toronto International Film Festival provides us with an absolutely extraordinary opportunity to experience a generous portion of this work. But I would remark that there are relatively few film directors within Chinese cinema who have had, by the fortune of their circumstance, their genius and talent, been able to show the sustained focus on an artistic project, or shown the kind of rigor in making film after film, as is true of the film director Hou Hsiao-hsien. Fewer yet have assumed such a pivotal place in global cinema as Hou Hsiao-hsien. So it's a privilege here to discuss Ho with two critics as discerning and knowledgeable about him as Professors Bordwell and Udden. David Bordwell's contributions to cinema studies are diverse, and their impact has been both deep and wide. Together with Kristen Thompson, Bordwell wrote the Standard University Introductory Cinema Textbook, Film Art, now in its 10th edition, and published in a great many languages. Professor Bordwell has written studies on film narrative, methods of interpretation, the history of Hollywood cinema. His book-length director studies of Dreyer, Ozu, Eisenstein, and others have set new standards in scholarship and critical imagination. As professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Bordwell has guided the doctoral work of many important scholars. Now retired from classroom teaching, Bordwell continues in another medium through the vigorously written blog, Observations on Film Art, which he co-authors with Kristen Thompson. On this occasion, I should accent Professor Bordwell's contribution to our knowledge and understanding of Chinese cinema. His book, Planet Hong Kong, Popular Cinema and the Art of Entertainment, initially published in 2000, came at a crucial moment in discussions of Chinese cinema. Bordwell afforded Hong Kong filmmakers just the right kind of balanced critical recognition. His is an empathetic and insightful analysis of the industry, of Hong Kong's leading artists, and Bordwell offers close analysis of Hong Kong's very particular intensified cinematic culture. The book was badly needed at the time and was warmly received, particularly in Hong Kong. Planet Hong Kong has had a career as a powerful corrective to the twin distortions that beset Hong Kong cinema. On one hand, critical condescension, and on the other hand, critical over-theorization. When Planet Hong Kong fell out of print, Bordwell undertook the job of updating and producing a beautiful electronic version in 2010. The extensive new stills and the new writing in the book and the updating of the book are all very welcome. This book, by the way, is available through David's website and is an amazing bargain at $15. David Bordwell will be delivering a lecture on Hong Kong action cinema here Monday at 6:30 p.m. Between the two editions of Planet Hong Kong, Bordwell produced two books, Figures Traced in Light in 2005, and Poetics of Cinema in 2008. These books exemplify a refinement of his rigorous work on film style. And it is in the pages of Figures Traced by Light in Light that we find Bordwell's revelatory chapter on Hou Hsiao-hsien's films. And he actually starts back with the commercial movies homemade before the start of the Taiwanese cinema, and then he continues into a detailed discussion of Ho's major phases as an art cinema director of international renown. Professor James Udden began as a history student before he became involved in film studies. Casting about for travel opportunities upon graduation as an undergraduate, Udden decided to teach English in Taiwan, perhaps for 6 months. Well, he wound up living in Taiwan for 5.5 years. Udden mastered Mandarin, he married there, and he did translations and research. On his return to the U.S., Udden joined the graduate cinema program at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. In the course of his doctoral work, he returned to Taiwan and conducted many views with Ho, as well as other key figures in Taiwanese cinema. Udden's first book, No Man, an Island, The Cinema of Hou Hsiao-hsien, was published by Hong Kong University Press in 2009. It is the only English language book devoted to Ho. It is also the best book we have on Taiwan New Cinema. Udden's book is a paragon of clarity, historical insight, thoroughness, and critical discernment. Professor Udden teaches at Gettysburg College in Pennsylvania. He is now at work on a study of Taiwan and Iranian cinemas, seeking to explain how they became so central to world film culture. James Udden has been a featured lecturer at the University of Toronto's Asian Institute Symposia on Taiwanese cinema, and it's very good to have him back in Toronto again. So please welcome David Bordwell and James Udden. So James and David and I have conspired just a little bit before we sat down, and we'd ask James to speak first a little bit about the film and about Ho, and then David and I will respond to him.
Thank you. It's always wonderful to be in Toronto. It seems like I'm coming back to Toronto at least once a year, thanks to Bart's invitation. I'm very happy to be back again. I thought I'd write down a few notes for today for the reason that I don't want to ramble on too long. There's just a couple of things I wanted to talk about this film, because there seems to be something afoot about Destined to Win in the particular, because I have long felt that this is one of Ho's more overlooked films. The films he made before this have gotten more attention. The films he made after this have gotten a lot of attention, and they deserve that attention. This is the film that's been relatively overlooked. But in the last few months, I've been asked to write a chapter about this film in a new anthology about Ho that's being published by the Columbia University Press. And then this happens. So I'm very, very happy, because I feel like this film is finally getting its due. Now, there's three things I'd like to briefly explain here. First of all, how this particular film came to be. Second of all, why I personally consider it sort of the definitive Ho film of the new cinema period. And then why, if that is the case, why was this film relatively overlooked? So I want to start with how this film got made, or I should say almost did not get made. Orson Welles apparently said once that all the best things in films are accidents. In many ways, Dust was a fortunate accident from the start. First, there was a long delay between his previous film, A Time to Live, A Time to Die, 11 months. At this point in his career, 11 months is a long hiatus. Ho was actually very busy in 1985 when he shot this film, visiting film festivals for the first time. He was going to one film festival after another. He was also just not sure what his next film should be about. He sort of hit a mental block. What should my next film be about? So there were three ideas that were toyed with. The first is an unrealized project that would have been co-produced with West Germany's Channel 2. I have no idea what that project was going to be. It was never made. The second was actually City of Sadness, which he did eventually make. However, at the time, in 1985, when this film was made, Taiwan was still under martial law. And so the original idea for City of Sadness was for the film to take place in the aftermath of a famous 1947 massacre It was going to take place in 1952, and it probably wasn't going to directly deal with that incident. There were also, believe it or not, plans of using the Hong Kong actor Chow Yun-fat in that film at that point. So they're very fortunate that they did not decide to shoot City of Sadness at that time, because in 1987, martial law was lifted, and that meant that, in fact, they could deal more directly with this very controversial event in Taiwan's history. So the third idea was Dust in a Wind, and it was really an afterthought. And Ho only decided to do it because his most trusted advisor, a man named Zhang Hongzhi, actually told him, this is the film you should do for now. And so Ho decided, okay, I'm going to do this particular film. Now, the second thing about this film was the incredible number of delays during the production itself. Boys of Hong Kui, that he shot in 1983, took only 22 days to shoot. Summer at Grandpa's only took 28 days to shoot. A Time to Live, The Time to Die, because it was more historical in nature, took 44 days to shoot. They had planned 30 days for Dust in the Wind. It took 45 actual production days, and it took over 3 months because there were so many delays during production. First of all, during the making of this film, they had three typhoons, and that cost them 9 days of shooting. And the very last shot you see of the film, the clouds and things like that, that's the aftermath of a typhoon. I mean, it was a very serendipitous moment that they could take that particular shot. And also, Ho, while he was shooting the film, had to make yet another trip both to New York and D.C. It was his first trip to the United States for yet more screenings at the Lincoln and Kennedy Center. Now, the other thing that's interesting about this film are the very technical issues they ran into, because this was the first time that Ho and his crew, Mark Lee, cinematographer, used an RE3 camera, and it was a step forward. You look at the light sensitivity, the way they were able to use the light in this film compared to his previous film was a real step forward. It was also a step forward because RE3 had a larger magazine. It could hold more film stock than an RE2 that they've been using before. Now, the problem they ran into was the old man, Li Tianlu, who's a famous puppeteer in Taiwan. Ho decided he was just too old to be brought back in to do post-dubbing, because at this time, all Taiwanese films were dubbed in post. They did not do any on-set sound, but the problem they ran into when they used the camera was they could hear the camera. And so what they did is they got these huge, thick blankets and put it over the camera, and that forced Mark Lee to not be able to move the camera. And the fortunate thing about this is it sort of led to a very unusual trait about this film. This film actually edits very little, and yet the camera does not move very much. It's a very static camera for a film with very, very long takes. Another thing to note, the music was an accident. They couldn't decide between the pan flute and the guitar music. They use mostly the guitar music throughout the film. But at the end, you hear the pan flute and the guitar music. That's just because at some point in post-production, Ho happened, or somebody else happened to hear both music at the same time, and they thought, well, why don't we just combine the two? And that's precisely what they decided to do it. The music itself is done by a very famous musician in Taiwan, Chen Minjiang, who also did the music for The Puppet Master in 1993. Another thing to note, and the last thing I'd like to note, is that this film received very lukewarm support from the government. It was the last film that Ho made at the Central Motion Picture Company. At that time, the Central Motion Picture Company was run directly by the KMT Party. That was the only party in power in 1986 when this film came out. They tried to dock pay for the 9 days due to the typhoon, and Ho decided, that's enough. I'm no longer going to work with them. The military refused to let them shoot on, in the subtitles here, they call it Quemoy, but it's really Jinmen Island. It's an island actually within, you can see the mainland from that particular island. Taiwan still has that island to this day. But the reason why the military didn't want to support the film is because they didn't like the fact that this film, the main narrative event was a young man having a breakup due to the draft. And they thought this is bad for the image of the military. I also wanted to note the scene with the fishermen. That's a very interesting scene. This was common practice at Jinmen and Matsu, the other island that Taiwan has. They would give a lot of gifts like that. So him giving the lighter was very, very true to that situation. The one thing the film doesn't show is the other thing they always did when they brought in those fishermen or other people who got stranded on these islands is they showed them a propaganda film. They didn't show that in this particular film. Now, this film was shut out completely from Taiwan's own Golden Horse Awards. That's their Oscars. And the reason was it didn't qualify because it's 90%, roughly 95% in the Taiwanese dialect. And to be in the Golden Horse, you had to be a Mandarin language film at that time. That's no longer the case today. But, you know, it's a good result for Ho in a way, because this is where he's finally able to sever his ties forever with the CMPC, the Central Motion Picture Company, really rely on outside sources for funding, not relying on the government alone anymore for funding his films. Now, despite all these obstacles and accidents, the result is, to me anyhow, almost the perfect Ho film and almost the perfect new cinema film. Because you have to consider how the new cinema was defined by a lot of people. Robert Chen has written a book on new cinema, and he lists several traits of what qualified as a new cinema film. And there's three that are very noteworthy. First of all, he says long takes. Second, static camera. Third, history filtered through the memories of common people. You see all three of those traits in this particular film. Now, it's really important to compare this film with another notable Taiwanese film from 1986, The Terrorizers by Edward Yang, an equally great film. 1986 was a great year for Taiwanese cinema. Yes, that film has a lot of static camera shots like this film. However, its average shot length is less than half of what this film is. This film is over a half a minute on average per shot. That film was only 14 seconds per shot. Okay. Otherwise, The Terrorizers was set in the present day, and it doesn't really fit the category of a new cinema film the way Robert Chen describes it in many ways. So the fact is that Ho really is the person who came to define Taiwanese cinema, more so than Edward Yang, the other great director from the 80s. And this is true even after the new cinema is said to have ended officially in 1987. As a matter of fact, an article in 1995 by a scholar named Huang Yingfeng describes Taiwan's festival style. And he's not too flattering about this style. But he says the problem is all the Taiwanese directors are doing nothing but long takes and static camera. Just set the camera there, don't move it. That's the Taiwanese style. And this is why we don't have a popular cinema anymore. Now, The Terrorizers, no doubt, is an equally great film from 1986. But the other filmmakers in Taiwan did not follow Yang's particular brand of modernist filmmaking. Instead, everybody seemed to follow what Ho is doing. And it's not just in Taiwan. Eventually, in the 90s, even to the present day, there are directors all over Asia who have toyed with this static camera, long take style. Half of them acknowledge that Ho is the direct influence on them. Half of them don't. But it's very clear that Ho is probably one of the most influential directors in Asia, at least for those directors who make films for film festivals. Now, if this is the case, if this particular film really brings that style to the fore, even more than his previous film, so why then was it overlooked? Well, I would say, in a nutshell, Dustin Nguyen was a victim of bad timing. First of all, it failed at the domestic box office, but then again, what was new, okay? That was true of Ho's previous film, three films. They didn't do well in the domestic box office. That was also true of Edward Yang's film. That was actually true of most of the new cinema films. Thus, merely reinforced Ho's reputation within Taiwan as box office poison. So this alone wouldn't really explain why this film was overlooked, because that should be true of his other films. What is more important is that this film didn't have the same impact as the previous three films in the realm that Ho was already very successful in. And what I'm talking about are international film festivals at this time, primarily in Europe. Here's what happened with the previous three films. Boys from Phong Quay won the top prize at the Three Continents Festival at Nantes. That happened in 1984, and that is the true beginning of Ho and Taiwan as a festival powerhouse that basically goes on for the next two decades. Summer Grandpas, his next film, same festival, same top prize. And what's very interesting for my purposes is that it shared the top prize with an Iranian film called The Runner, and that was the beginning of Iran's rise as suddenly a festival powerhouse. And Iran and Taiwan throughout the 90s into the 2000s were the two big stars in international festival circuit. A Time for Time to Live, Time to Die was the first time a Taiwanese film really played in a major festival, in this case in Berlin. That some of the major festivals had tried to get these films and then backed out, we think, due to pressure from the People's Republic of China to shut them out. Berlin finally decided, after Ho had won two straight years in ninth, we got to take a chance on this guy. The only problem is it was shown outside of the competition. But even though it was shown outside of the competition, it got a Fopresky Prize, which is a special critics prize at Berlin. Now, Dust didn't get that. It did go to Berlin, and it did go back to Nantes, but there was no critics' prize this time in Berlin. And at Nantes, it did not receive a best picture like his previous films has, because it wasn't shown in the competition. There's a simple explanation for this. Alain Jeladeau, the founder of that festival, told me that, well, we couldn't put it in the competition again. He had already won twice. That was bad form. I absolutely loved Dust. And they, even though it wasn't in the competition, they still gave it two awards for best cinematography and for best music, which are awards that, in fact, Nantes doesn't usually give out. They didn't last year when I was there. So really, the next step for Ho was to enter the competition of a top-tiered film festival. That didn't happen until September of 1989 with City of Sadness, where it entered the world's oldest film festival. And in fact, it not only entered the competition, it won the top prize. And that was a tremendous breakthrough for Taiwanese cinema. Now, the other thing to note is that in 1986, or I should say even in 1987, it got overshadowed at the time by the performance of Edward Yane's The Terrorizer, because Edward Yane's The Terrorizer did win the Silver Leopard at Locarno in 1987, and it also won the Golden Horse for Best Dramatic Feature in 1987. So it just sort of got a victim of a bad timing. It just didn't quite have the impact that his other films have. Now, in conclusion, I want to just say this. It's not that nobody noticed this. It seems like the people who do see this film are very deeply moved by it. I am one of those people. I saw it on Taiwanese television in the early 90s. My wife told me to watch it. She says, "You love Ho. This is the one film you got to see." And I really remember that. Now, one critic in 1986, I think, said it very, very well. And this is a direct quote. Quote, "With this film, Taiwan finally has a work of art that can compare with the economic miracle," unquote. Now, I want to point out that the second time I saw this film, I finally saw it on the big screen, and it was in a film aesthetics class in my first or second year of graduate school, taught by this gentleman right here at Wisconsin. Now, today I teach a similar course almost every year at Gettysburg College. And not once have I not used this film, because this is perfect for several fundamental issues of aesthetics, episodic narrative structure, unusual narration via unusual stylistic characteristics that I talked about, and, of course, the core issue of realism. Now, there may be better candidates out there, but I have yet to find one. For now, this film suits me just fine for my teaching purposes. And that's basically what I wanted to say about it. Thank you.
Very informative and rich presentation. David, would you like to jump in?
Yeah, I mean, I can't really supplement much of what Jim has said, because the kind of depth and intensity of detail of the research that he's done on the context around Ho is really something you have to check out for yourself. It's really remarkable, if you look at his book, how he supplies political, cultural, very dense context of the new cinema movement, Ho's career, and films like this in particular, but also a very rich sense of the particular contributions that Ho makes to both his national cinema and to world cinema. And I'm not a historian of Chinese cinema. I'm interested in particular problems of film history and film art. I guess I could put it this way, that I'm interested in the history of forms, the ways in which people have made films, the ways in which the sort of tacit assumptions about what a movie should be and how it should behave have informed the creative choices that they make in different times and places. So I'm a kind of a comparative historian rather than a national cinema historian, even though I have worked on particular national cinemas, as Bart said in his very overkind introduction. I'm also interested in trying to explain those creative decisions that filmmakers make and the ways in which they respond to the medium of cinema. I'm interested in the conditions of creation, the circumstances around which filmmakers make their films. And sometimes that involves the biography of the filmmaker, the personal life of the filmmakers that are made, that find their way into the film. But also I'm interested in these what we might call the culture of filmmaking, the production, the industry, the ways in which filmmakers respond to their audiences, the ways in which they respond to technical challenges or technical changes. And so in a way, what I'm interested in is kind of, if I can put it in a grandiose way, this history of cinematic forms as informed by creative choices that are themselves sort of shaped by the artistic context in which films are made. And so Ho and swam into my ken because I found two different dimensions, we might say, to his work that fascinated me, and it seemed quite unique, or at least very distinctive, across the history of film. One is the ways in which he tells the stories. I mean, one of the things we have to confront if we're interested in the history of aesthetic forms in cinema is narrative, because not all films are narratives, of course, but many, many, many films are, and most of the films that audiences around the world come to see are narrative-based. And that brings up a lot of interesting questions with Ho and with other people, because film from the beginning has been a popular medium in many ways. Many artists have used it, many high and fine artists have used it, but in its origins, it's a popular medium of expression. And that means that some of the people who create what has been called film language back in the early decades of cinema were people working in contact with a popular audience. The art of cinema begins as a popular art. So people like D.W. Griffith and Louis Fayad and Victor Sjostrom and Raoul Walsh and many, many filmmakers of the teens and 20s are working for an immediate audience, a popular audience. It's only a bit later or on the edges that people with different aesthetics come into play. So narrative is one way in which audiences have responded to cinema, and particular popular cinema. And what fascinated me, as Bart said in that introduction, is that Hou Hsiao-hsien comes out of a popular storytelling context. He begins making films, essentially romantic comedy dramas with a very strong musical dimension, his first three directed films, and they're fascinating to study as almost little laboratories for some of the things he's going to try in the rather different context of the new Taiwanese cinema. There are many things to talk about in terms of Ho's narrative strategies. I don't want to try to preempt all that, but just a couple things strike me, and they bear on some of the things that Jim has already said. First, one of the most striking things, I think, and it bears on this notion of realism, is that Ho gives a very strong sense of mundane reality, of everyday life and its routines and habits. In fact, those rise to the surface and become salient in a way that they don't in the work of other filmmakers. By that I mean, if you think of how routines are rendered, say, in popular storytelling cinema in America, yes, we understand that dad comes home from work, and yes, we understand that mom is there waiting with a meal, and we understand the kids have come home from school. But those daily routines are woven into a more dramatic or crisis-ridden structure. So dad's come home from work because he's just gotten a promotion, or because he's been fired, or because there's rivalry at work. And mom is preparing these things, but the kids are having trouble at school, or the girl is mad at her parents and leaves in a huff. I mean, you can see how these everyday routines get sort of serve as a kind of neutral backdrop for what we think of as drama with crises and climaxes and conflicts and things like that. What's fascinating about Ho, and he's not completely unique here, but it's especially salient, I think, is the way in which a lot of that, what we think of as high drama, dramatic material, is somehow withheld from us. And the focus becomes much more on the daily routines. Little by little, things simply go along, simply happen. Another great filmmaker who uses this, of course, is Ozu Yasujiro, the great Japanese director, where the drama sort of sneaks up on you. It sort of accumulates on the edges or in between the interstices of these daily routines. And Hou does that, I think, in a very striking way. He will leave gaps. It's as if we get what happened before and what happened after, but not what most filmmakers would include as the dramatic event. Think of when Huyen comes in and waits on the platform for Wan. He's supposed to come pick her up. Well, we see her waiting, and then we cut to a shot of her being sort of accosted by this masher, this guy who's trying to drag her off with him. The dramatic confrontation has been elided, has been skipped over, and Wan has to come to her rescue, in the process of which he spills the lunchbox. And Hou gives us a close-up of this lunchbox because it really isn't too easy to see in that rather lengthy, long shot that he's given us of Wan driving off the masher. But why do we get this close-up of the lunchbox? Well, it's not really revealed until a scene or two later when we learn that he was supposed to deliver the lunchbox to the lady whose child is missing his lunch that day, and the lady who comes in and complains to his boss, and so on. So there's a sense of backing and filling. The thing that would have been the most dramatic, that is, Wan saying to Huyen, oh no, I this lunchbox, now my job's at risk because I was supposed to bring it for this boy, skipped over. And you get the reaction of his response to the situation he's in, this pressure of things closing in on him, but not the triggering action. Now that's a striking effect, and I think you can trace it. We can discuss this more if you want. We can trace this throughout the whole film. And in fact, the whole film is based, I think, on suppressing those moments of high drama. Like, imagine the moment when the postman comes to pick up on their first date. But that's all gone. That's all refracted through people's responses to it rather than given directly. I think also what's fascinating to me is the way in which these things exfoliate throughout the film so that what seem to be very personal incidents and casual day-by-day routines gather a greater and greater weight. Seeing this again, I'm reminded of how the film is partly about kids in the city, which his other films have been too, like Boys in Feng Shui. But now it's the countryside in the city, this is a theme throughout Hou's early work, gets really accentuated and pulled to a kind of pitch. Because the last third of the film is almost about deep history, it seems to me now. It's about the employer saying, I remember those days in the jungle where we were virtually cannibals. Or it's about his father remembering the war at the very end of the 40s. Or it's about the grandfather, whose final words to Wan aren't shown to us. He sees him to the station, and we see them in extreme long shot. But what he actually says to him is suppressed, I think, in order to give a greater weight to what he says at the very end, which is about the typhoon destroying the crops and potatoes being harder to grow than ginseng. And it's almost as if these layers of Taiwanese history, these older men are peeling them away for the boy who's gone off to the army. And by the end, the grandfather can say, well, you know, this is just the way it is. This is nature. I mean, it's no longer history, but something very cosmic about the way the weather behaves and the way in which these people fit into that overall cycle or rhythm. So this kind of narrative starts small, I think, and sort of gets bigger and bigger in its implications, but again, through this very discreet and partial presentation. So if you're interested in the history of filmic storytelling, all his films are ripe for this, but this idea of skipping over important things and then waiting, giving the counterweight to quotidian things is crucial, I think, for understanding how his films work. The other thing which Jim mentioned, and which I'll mention very quickly, is the way in which the films are put together shot by shot. Since you make an aesthetic decision to hold the shot, to sustain it longer, and since you make an aesthetic decision not to move the camera, and that's a crucial difference because a lot of filmmakers use long takes. Even today in modern cinema, there's a kind of virtuosic conception of how you use a long take with very complicated camera moves. Think of Tree of Life or any of these films that have sort of self-congratulatory long takes. You don't lock the camera down if you're going to hold the shot a long time. You have to keep it moving for visual variety so that the audience is still engaged. But Hou does. Hou locks it down. And that means the weight really falls on your actors and the way you stage the actions that they perform. And this is hard for me to talk about without actual examples in front of me to point to, but I think you registered the kind of intricate choreography that goes on in many of these scenes. Think of the kids gathering for the meal behind the screen in the movie theater when Ying sort of wanders up and looks into the projector. That whole meal that they have together, sort of impromptu meal, is really exquisitely staged so that you're seeing exactly what Hou wants you to see at any given moment. But what's critical about it is that it isn't done in a very flashy way. one of the issues of realism that Jim raises, I think, is how the naturalistic quality of the performances, the individual facial responses, the sort of tacit and suppressed emotion that you get in the facial responses and gestures is kind of again repeated in the way the actors interact with each other. It's very discreet, very, some people would say minimal, but actually it's extremely rich at the moment-by-moment level, but it's really hidden. The skill of this is really quite hidden because it's just people gathering around a table, assembling a meal, or people sitting on the stoop smoking and talking to each other. All these sort of very basic human activities are masking a really complex way of laying out space in over the passage of time in a single shot. So, as, again, if you're looking at this from the standpoint of the history of film, Ho is reactivating a tradition that's there in the history of cinema, running throughout the history of cinema, of observational cinema and complex staging of action, but is very much forgotten now, I would say. Ho, as Jim says, did revive it for a lot of filmmakers who were open to being influenced by it. But actually, it's quite rare in popular cinema now to have shots of this kind with elaborate blocking. It's much more common and fashionable, indeed, to have a lot of fast cuts with a lot of camera movements and a lot of special effects that just keep that energy level cranked up. But with Ho, the movie, you can just let the movie cook along. It just rolls. And it's partly because he's so carefully hidden the artistic manipulation that he's executed. So for me, at least those two dimensions, apart from the intrinsic emotional qualities of the film and its place in Taiwanese cinema history, for me, Ho becomes an example of whole new dimensions of what people can do with cinema. The possibilities of this medium are opened up wider, I think, when a director like Ho really pursues what Bart called at the beginning a kind of consistent artistic project.
Now, I'd like to raise a question because both of you have certainly made us much more aware than we might have been before of the sophistication of Ho. But in fact, Ho does not begin as a filmmaker as a sophisticate. He's in fact someone of provincial sensibility. His remarkable achievement comes through practice and through listening to those around him in conversation. I wonder if you say something about, we might say, his artistic biography in this respect. Because when you spoke of him, one thinks of, you know, the extremely well-educated filmmakers that come out of certain traditions. And I might say the extraordinary educational tradition that lays behind, for example, the fifth-generation filmmakers on the mainland. Ho is operating in a film culture that is not like that at all. And he's not a tuned-up guy. So we might say something about his biography in this respect.
Yeah, his biography is rather unusual on many levels. He had no plans of becoming a filmmaker. Then he ended up going to an arts college, and he sort of ended up in a film program, but he wasn't really interested. He said it, he told me it wasn't really a film program because there was no film equipment. It was really just a theater program. He was thinking about maybe becoming an actor, and he says, I'm too short to really be an actor, but that's what I really wanted to do. I wanted to be an actor. So way back in 1973, he's out of school. He's completed his military service, and he's got to find a job. And so he just pretty much stumbles upon the set at the Central Motion Picture Company and starts making what were called Chongyao films. He's not a director. He's initially a continuity person. And the first film that he worked on was with a very famous director from the 1970s, a man named Li Xing. And it's a really sappy, and I cannot tell you how sappy these films were from the 70s. They're sap you want to wear, you know, some protective clothing to watch these films. they're quite unbelievable. This film was called A Heart Tied in a Million Knots, and it's just unbelievable to think that this is where his career began. And so he slowly works his way through a commercial film industry. He sees how films are made, and he says that's how he learned to make films, or as he puts it, that's how I learned not to make films. Because he says it was so frustrating to work in that industry in the 70s because there were so many limitations. They were not purely political. They were also economic. In the Taiwanese film industry of the 70s, even though they made a lot of films, they were very cheaply made. they did everything in their power to not waste the least amount of film stock. And so they would have incredibly low shooting ratios. They would try to get them down to 3-to-1 to 2-to-1, very, very low shooting ratios. So you just don't waste film stock. He said it's very hard to get good performances when you're not using much film stock. And so he was very frustrated with that when he was an assistant director, because in the 70s, apparently, directors didn't direct. Directors went out and drank tea and played mahjong. It was the assistant directors who actually made the films. He was an assistant director for several films. He made several films as an assistant director. And this is when he learned this is just not the way to make a film. So when he becomes a director, starting in 1980, he just slowly figures out maybe there are other ways of doing it. And David was talking about that. His first three films, which are part of this popular film industry, they're really surprising for people who know Hou, the later Hou, that he made films like this. They're really not like the later Hou films in a lot of ways, but in some ways there are. There are already signs that here's a guy who decided he was going to do things differently. One of the first things he started to do differently was, I'm going to use a master shot. Now, he didn't know what a master shot was. I should explain what a master shot is. In a Hollywood scenario, the way you do a scene is you shoot the entire scene from beginning to end in a master shot, okay? Usually the camera is far away, we'll have a lot of camera movement, and you might only use bits and pieces of one or two of those takes. You might do several takes in the master shot, and then you do what is coverage. You put the camera in many other different camera setups, you adjust the lighting for each camera setup, and then you edit that all together. That's the typical Hollywood film. In Taiwan, they didn't do master shots. They did shot A, shot B, shot C, shot D. Don't waste any film stock. Okay, you flub the line, that's okay. We'll work it out in the post-dubbing and things like that. Don't worry about that. And they were really shoddily made. Well, he started to realize, why do I have to do shot B? I don't always have to do shot B. And you only see it in a few scenes in his early film, but he started to do this. Now, as far as world film culture and things like that, he knew nothing about these previous traditions that David was talking about. He knew nothing about silent films in the 1910s and that were made in Europe that did this long take static camera style. He didn't know about Ozu. He didn't see Ozu until, in fact, this was the first film where he knew who Ozu was. He saw a film that was introduced to him when he was in Paris after being in Nantes, a man named Marco Muller, who at that time was consulting for the Venice Film Festival, says, I got a film to show you. And he showed him a silent film by Ozu from 1932 called I Was Born But. And that was the first time he realized, I really like this guy. I can really relate to Ozu. And now, up to that point, people were already telling him, you're so Ozu-like, but he didn't know who Ozu was. He really just intuitively faced the problems that he had gone through in a decade, the day-to-day problems of working in a really weird environment in some ways, and just sort of slowly overcoming those problems when he became a director himself. When the new cinema began in 1982 or 83, sort of began by accident. It was a response to the crisis in the industry. Well, for Hou, it was a great opportunity, because at this point, they finally decided, we can't tell these young directors to do it any other way, because everything else we've been doing is now failing, so let's just let these young directors do whatever they want to do. Well, that's what Hou pretty much did.
So. Now, there's another setting, so you've brought us to that setting for Hou. When the Taiwanese New Cinema came, Hou and others attached themselves to a vibrant and politically charged literary movement that had to do with what you represented and how you represented it. And here's someone who's working with, you might say, the candy-colored scripts and the candy-colored idea of what film material should be for popular cinema. Maybe we could say something about the shift in context, not so much in terms of filmmaking per se, but the literary background, who began to become players as, we might say, screenwriters and so forth.
Yeah, that's actually a very important point to bring up. There's a larger cultural context here. Now, it's just true of cinema anywhere. In the past, cinema is always a little bit slower to catch up to trends that begin in other art forms. Let's take German Expressionism as an example. German Expressionism was a film movement that began in 1919 with the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. But German Expressionism as a theatrical movement predated World War I. As a visual arts movement predated World War I. So the way to look at this is that cinema, when these movements eventually hit cinema, that's sort of when it's hit the mainstream. That's, in a way, the way to look at it. It's become more mainstream because it's in the really true mass medium of the time, namely cinema. In a way, the new cinema was the same thing. It brought in a lot of what was going on in the 70s in literature. And the screenwriter for this film, Unyan Jun, is a very interesting figure because he was a member of what was called the nativist movement. And this was a movement that the main writer was a man named Huan Chunming. And that particular writer wrote a lot of stories in the 70s that were about daily life in Taiwan. And it was a reaction against a movement in the 60s that were known as the modernists, who in the history of Chinese literature anywhere were the most experimental writers of all time. Now, when the nativist movement emerged, sort of a reaction against this, they said, you are ignoring the common people in Taiwan. Well, one of these people was Unyan Jun, who starts writing these stories, and then he works for the Central Motion Picture Company. And he works under a man named Xiao Ye. And the two of them realized that a crisis was afoot in the Central Motion Picture Company, and they were the ones who suggested to the head of the Central Motion Picture Company, why don't you bring in some new blood? Why don't you let young new people come in and make films? And a lot of these people came in and they made films based on these the literary movement of the 70s, the nativist movement, and also on the modernist movement of the 60s. People ignore that, in fact, the modernists, some of the new cinema works are also based on modernist works as well. And that literary fermenting was really, really important for the new cinema. And some people like Peggy Chow, who's a very famous critic, I just interviewed her again in December in Taipei, and she told me, you know, the new cinema didn't begin in 1982. It began long before that. There was just so much going on. There was modern dance. Taiwan actually had the leading modern dance company in Asia. It was the Cloud Gate Company. That would really taken off in the 70s. There's just all these other things going on in other art forms. And the new cinema just sort of represented that cinema was catching up. The only problem is, in this case, it didn't really make it mainstream. Because the new cinema didn't, except for a few films, the initial film, that didn't do really well at the box office, it did well where they didn't expect it to do well at all, or where they were not even aware of this world, the international festival world. And that's what Taiwanese cinema eventually becomes primarily, is a festival cinema.
So. Yeah, I guess the only thing I would say in relation to Ho's career is that I actually see considerable continuity between the first three films and the later films, partly because of the city-country dialectic, which is there in all of them, but also, again, about his penchant for realism. Because in those films, you do have a fairly staple, though I think quite enjoyable, set of romantic plots at the center of the film. Young people, urban sophisticates, falling in love with each other, walking through parks to pop tunes, things like that. And they're really nice pop tunes, I have to say. But on the edges, Ho's shooting on location, one of his key decisions was to maximize the use of locations. It's not like the other films of the 70s didn't use locations. Indeed, you get the sense that they couldn't afford many sets and, in fact, use people's houses in the interiors for locations, and it can create some pretty strange effects. But they actually do use locations pretty generically. And there's never really an interest in those things going on around the edges of the main character's action. Whereas with Ho, partly because of the way he shoots with rather long lenses, there's always something around to look at, urban Taipei or the countryside or something like this. While our handsome young people are having their love affair, there's all this other stuff going on. And I guess I would say, if you look particularly at the last film of those three, The Green, Green Grass of Home, that film is kind of a rough prototype for some of the things we see here.
In fact, some people do say that that's the first true new cinema film. They say his third film, The Green, Green Grass of Home, and so he was a logical candidate to join the movement when it began. It came out the same year as the first official film of the new cinema in our times.
Yeah, it's a fascinating film because it's about a boy who comes from the city to become a teacher, a substitute teacher in a rural country, in a country school. And his interaction with the people there and his discovery, really, of rural life. In effect, it's about him learning that parent-child relations are very different. And child-child relations are very different in the countryside than they are in the city. So you get that same interest in the ordinary person that isn't typical of the Cheng Yao films and the other kind of the Wen Yi dramas that we get. It's really about everyday life at some level, even though it's absorbed within a formulaic kind of a musical story. But I think that he's the ideal person. He's in exactly the right frame of mind to see how he can appropriate this nativism and the naturalistic bent it has into something that's emotionally gripping, like as he had managed to do in those early films.
Now, we have a little time left. We should raise the lights a bit and the mics and take questions from the audience if there are any.
Yes. Thanks for the fantastic discussions about this director. I have one question from both of you. One regarding, because you talk about Edward Young and Hou Hsiao, and there is no discussions about Tessa Yiming, because I think that Tessa Yiming has some qualities that he describes about, for example, long takes or interesting in the what happenings in ordinary way of life. And some of his movies, like Neon Lives or Vive l'amour or Rivers, in them we can see the same qualities that we have seen in this movie. I'm just wondering what you think of his movies in relationship to this type of Taiwanese cinema. And because what I see in this movie, which is interesting compared to Tessa Yiming, is they are very interested in what's happening in ordinary way of life, what's happening, the impact of society, socioeconomics on human life, and which is, it seems that unique takes in Taiwanese art cinema. I'm just wondering if it is types of tradition that is continuing in their movies. This is my questions from you. And I have also questions from Bordwell, because I'm thinking a lot about your articles about art cinema in 1970, and you talked about what are the qualities of, for example, good European movies that makes them distinct from the other mainstream cinema. I'm just wondering regarding this type of new movies like Taiwanese cinema, what do you see as a types of unique contributions of this type of genre or cinema to the art? Do you see the same things that that happening, the same quality, the same genre styles that is moving, or do you think that there are, they add some things to the language or grammar of cinema? That's my questions. And
So there are two questions. They're both extremely rich questions, and thanks very much for them. If I can see, the first question is about the relationship of Ho to other filmmakers within the Taiwanese cinema, particularly in terms of the style and narrative features that you've already outlined.
Chai Ming-Liang specifically, yeah.
Right. Well, Chai Ming-Liang is the best one to talk about because he starts a lot later than Ho. He doesn't start until 1992. With Rebels of the Neon God. He is not actually Taiwanese. He's Malaysian Chinese. He studied at the university, at the Cultural University in Taiwan. That's when he realized that Taiwan had this environment being created in the 80s that allowed him to make some rather idiosyncratic films himself. What you see over the course of his career is taking this aspect of Ho's style almost too literally. And what I'm talking about in particular is that he doesn't do the really intricate staging techniques that David talks about. As a matter of fact, no director is able to match Ho with that. I've never seen other directors who are quite able to do these densely staged scenes that Ho is able to do, such as we were talking about earlier, Flowers of Shanghai. It's incredible density within the shot. So many people moving in a very intricate fashion. But Tsai does take the long take very seriously, and he takes the static shot very seriously. As a matter of fact, the film What Time Is It There, that played at Cannes in 2001, that film averages almost a minute per shot. Not a single one of those shots moves even for the slightest reframing. It's a literal appropriation of that one aspect that's the easiest part of Ho to imitate. Okay? And there's a lot of other Asian directors who have done that to some extent. There's Korean directors who have done this at various points as well. But I think a lot of them miss what truly made Ho, Ho. What's really rich, but I think you would agree with this, the sort of richness of his actual staging techniques and the things that are very difficult to imitate. As for other directors, there was one other director that's really forgotten now that made films in the 80s who, unbelievably, as I looked at his films and started counting the number of shots and doing the math, and I don't think my math is that bad. I'm pretty sure I got this right. But there was one director who actually had longer takes than Ho in the 80s. And that's a director named Zhang Yi. He's forgotten now. He stopped his career after 1987. He stopped when the movement pretty much stopped. But what's very striking about his films is that even though he did longer takes, he did much more conventional narratives. And he also, they're kind of boring long takes compared to Ho. They don't have the richness, just that precise sense of composition that Ho has. So there are certain aspects of Ho that were very influential. Long takes without moving the camera, that was widely influential. There's other aspects that only a few directors seem to be able to do. Jia Zhang-ke, mainland China, is one who's able to do it to some extent. Hong San-soo in Korea is able to do it to some extent, but most of the other directors are not able to do that. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an interesting point because you do start to have individual stylists. After the new Taiwanese cinema appears, you do have directors within that are quite different. I would say Edward Yang Daishang is quite different from Hou Hsiao-hsien. And also after that, because it becomes a kind of burden of tradition for younger directors I have this very powerful, big brother or father figure of Hou Hsiao-hsien or Edward Yang Daishang. What do I do? What's left for me to do? And I would say in the case of Chai, although we could talk about others, he does three or four things that are pretty distinctive to him. And that isn't, for instance, an explicit focus on sexuality. This is something you don't really see in much of Hou Hsiao-hsien, even occasionally. He's really interested in eroticism, it seems to me, in various versions. He's also much more interested in the urban sophisticate, the yuppie, the person who's trying to make it in the big city. And there isn't that same sense, I think, of the resonance of history or the relationship of the country in the city that you have in Ho. In that respect, he's probably a little closer to Edward Yang, I suppose. There's also a sense, I think, of the grotesque in Chai Ming-liang, of exaggeration. You see it most wildly in Wayward Cloud. That's the right? Wayward Cloud is the name of it? Yeah. That's just so over the top. But you get it in the others too, like The Hole and others. I mean, it's playful, but it's also kind of really out there. And I guess the other thing I'd mention is that when he does use long takes, they're often gags. I think there's a very funny use, almost the tati use of the long take in the film Goodbye Dragon Inn, where there are all these men. It's about a movie theater that's kind of on its last legs and showing old Chinese classics. And it's partially used as a gay pickup site. So there's a lot of cruising going on. So there's one shot in a men's room with all the urinals lined up in depth. It's a really exaggerated wide-angle shot. And there's one guy already there urinating in the foreground at the closest urinal. And there are like six or eight urinals stretching into the distance. Another guy comes in and looks around and immediately chooses the one right next to this other guy. I mean, I suppose it's a male joke, because normally when men go to... Am I getting too personal about this? When men go to the...
For half the audience, you are.
I think women can visualize. They probably have seen it other ways. But when men go to use the restroom, they use the urinals, they don't... They try to avoid standing right next to another man, But in this shot, the guy just comes right up against him in the foreground. That kind of thing you would never get in Hou Hsiao-hsien. Never, I think. So there's a way in which they've absorbed the aesthetic of the other younger directors, and I think they can choose to take it in different directions or to handle certain aspects of it in their own personal ways. Chai would be a good example of personalizing some of these things, and again, taking them to new dimensions.
Now, the second part of that question, I'm a little less certain of, but I think that...
Maybe we can talk about it separately. Yeah.
Okay. So can we have another question? Is there another? Right here, please.
I have a short one. Is it a possibility that we have a historical context of this kind of new Taiwanese cinema movement in other Chinese-speaking films?
Well, the context is rather interesting because, as I think I mentioned before, it was largely an accident. It wasn't really a government policy. The official beginning is an anthology film called In Our Times in 1982. It was advertised as Taiwan's first art film in history. That was literally what the posters said. It was put out by the same studio that put out Dust in the Wind, which is a Central Motion Picture Company, which was run directly by the KMT party at the time. So it seems like this is a government-sponsored film because of that. Because at that time, the KMT was the only legal party in Taiwan. It was a one-party authoritarian state on its last legs in the 80s. It was still martial law and things like that. However, the reason that they even made that film was because the CMPC at that point was nearly bankrupt. It was in such bad financial shape because the main reason was the loss of recognition of the United States in 1979. That led the CMPC to undergo a new, they had always made propaganda films, but they decided to make even bigger propaganda films. They spared no expense in making these films. They were incredibly expensive. There was two in particular, The Lake of Martyrs and The Battle for the Republic of China, were unbelievably expensive compared to anything else that Taiwan was making at the time. And people in Taiwan saw these films because the government wanted to remind everybody why they, you know, we are the government. Even though we don't have U.S. recognition, we got to remind you. So they showed these films all over Taiwan and free. My wife remembers this time. She remembers both films. She says, oh, yeah, we saw those films, but none of us paid for those films. We just went to free screenings. So they spent millions and millions of dollars on these films and got no box office back. And they were in really bad shape. Everything else that Taiwan was doing, the Chong Yao films were really on their last leg. They were pretty successful in the 70s, both in Taiwan and other markets and overseas Chinese markets. Those were really taking a nosedive in the early 80s. And the CMPC made those films as well, along with private studios. Nothing was working. And I was just reminded of this, talking to people in Taiwan. I talked to Ho and I talked to other people. They all said the same thing. The government had no other choice. They had to do something new. And there were young Turks in the CMPC. It was Xiao Ye and Un Yanzhen who was one of the screenwriters for this film. As a matter of fact, that's Un Yanzhen's story. I can tell you a lot about that story. That's pretty funny, but that's another issue. They were the ones who just told the head of the CMPC, Ming Ji, who was a newcomer to the CMPC, who didn't know what to do. The amazing thing is Ming Ji was trying to think of anything, and he saw this dinosaur exhibit at a park that was run by the Central Motion Picture. They had sort of an amusement park that did displays, and there was a dinosaur exhibit, and he had this idea, I'm going to make a film about dinosaurs. He thought about Jurassic Park about 10 years before Jurassic Park came out, okay? And so he said, I'm going to make this film about dinosaurs, and Xiao Ye says, no, we don't have the money for that. I'll tell you what, here's what you do. Very low-budget films, but young, new directors, but you let them do what they want. And he said, well, nothing else is working. We're going to do that. The whole purpose was to save the domestic film industry. It was losing very badly to Hong Kong. And the new cinema completely failed at that. The popular industry just continued to decline throughout the 80s. In the 90s, it became virtually extinct. Okay, what they never expected, because the government did not understand this world at all, they never expected that these were going to do so well at film festivals, which was the unexpected result of the new cinema.
The only other context I would add is that I don't have a good general explanation, but what you have is an extraordinary renaissance of Chinese cinema throughout the 80s, yeah, in three different sites, in the mainland, the new generation, in Hong Kong popular cinema, but also Hong Kong art cinema, a film like Boat People, which Bart's going to be lecturing on, and of course in Taiwan. Something happened to coincide in the 80s, from the early 80s into the late part of the decade. There's just this fluorescence of Chinese film talent. Performers, directors, writers, all the things that Jim's been talking about. It's extraordinary that it should happen all in those three zones at the same time.
And they all met each other. They often met at the Taiwanese New Cinema Directors met the fifth generation at the Hong Kong Film Festival. That was a neutral meeting ground where they could actually go and meet each other. Because at that point, they couldn't go to mainland China. The mainland directors couldn't go to Taiwan. But they were able to meet in Hong Kong.
And the Hong Kong Film Festival was showing all their films,
too. They were showing
all
their films,
each other's work
Taiwan
in a way they could never see them at home.
Yeah. Yes.
Over here.
Hi. Thank you very much for this very informative talk. And I just wanted to ask two quick questions. One is about, they're complex questions, but I'll try to get them out very quickly. One is about the more direct political implications of the Taiwanese New Wave with the ending of martial law, like in 1987, and then the process of democratization in the early 90s, and what how we can kind of think of this film movement in relation to the massive political changes that happened so quickly after it, and how did this film movement contribute to debates about democratization and Taiwanese identity and the rise of opposition parties at that time? Because this is really like a huge time for transformations in Taiwanese politics as well. So I'm wondering how like Hou himself positioned his films and this movement in relation to these massive changes in political life. And then two, just quickly, what are your thoughts on the contemporary situation of cinema in Taiwan? Has this kind of high art style continued, or because like a lot of films I see right now from Taiwan are very commercial, like the Sai De Ke Balai and the Manka and all the and One Night in Taipei, and there's a very kind of almost like trying to compete with the commercial cinema of the mainland. So I don't know if you have any thoughts about contemporary Taiwanese cinema, but those are two questions.
Well, let me deal with the first question. Ho's political views are rather complex. He has gotten politically involved in a couple of times. He was briefly involved in the early 90s in a political party that was formed, didn't really go anywhere, that was actually formed by someone who was originally in the DPP. The DPP is the main opposition party to the KMT that was established in 1986. They actually, when they were established in 1986, it was still martial law. What they did was illegal. But John Jingguo, Chiang Kai-shek's son, who is still the ruler, still alive, said, that's okay, let him do it. We're going to be lifting martial law anyhow, let him do it. So there was one person who was upset with that party as well, decided to form his own party, didn't want to focus on issues of independence, but issues about how to keep Taiwan stable, develop, and not be caught in between the KMT and the DPP all the time. That seemed to reflect what Ho's view was. His political views are very, very indirect. They really are. But it depends on who you talk to. Some people, especially the people who wrote a book called Death of a New Cinema, a book that came out in 1991, were very, very disappointed with Ho. And what really started it was in 1987, Ho just merely helped out a friend who happened to be working in the government-run studio at that time to make a propaganda film. He just merely helped him out. But that news leaked out, and for many people, that was a betrayal. Now, I asked Ho personally about this. He told me I was just helping a friend. There was nothing political about that at all. I just helped out a friend. I wasn't trying to make a political statement or anything like that. I didn't even think anybody would know that I even helped out. So there are situations like that. So people who wrote this book harp on that, and then they really got him for City of Sadness. They felt City of Sadness was too indirect about the single most important event in Taiwan's history. The single most important event to this day is the 228 massacre of 1947. They felt he did a whitewashed job. They thought he was in cahoots with the Kuomintang, which was interesting because the hardcore faction of the Kuomintang felt that he was working for the communists and the Taiwanese independence people at the same time. The people who were really on either side of the spectrum in Taiwan, which is not right-left, it's either Taiwan versus China. That's the political spectrum in Taiwan. Right-left has no meaning in Taiwan whatsoever. They all thought Ho was in cahoots with the other side, with City of Sadness. Okay. But look at this film. This film is almost entirely in the Taiwanese dialect. At this time in 1986, you can't find another film that is almost entirely in the Taiwanese dialect. I have to rely completely on the subtitles here. I only understand a few phrases in Taiwanese.
But this has a political dimension as well.
Oh, it's a very political thing.
The KMT did everything possible to stamp out the indigenous languages, the indigenous dialects in Taiwan. Just as we might say in the 1920s and 30s, they attempted to stamp out Cantonese in southern China as a dialect that would have any identity politics attached. So when the nativist movement began working, they began introducing dialect elements. So when that comes over to films, this was politically charged, even though it doesn't have a direct political point. It wasn't, right? But the very fact of dialect was politically provocative.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons I was saying why it was shut out. It couldn't qualify for the Golden Horse for that reason, because it was primarily in the Taiwanese dialect. And that was a really provocative thing to do. The interesting thing about Ho, and I'm surprised how many times I have to explain this to Taiwanese. Most Taiwanese assume that Ho is what's called a Bunshenren. Bunshenren are the people who were there multi-generational before 1949. Yeah, they're the indigenous Taiwanese. Well, there's also the aboriginals and things like that, but they're only about 1% of the population. They're about 80, technically, I mean, now there's so much intermarriage, it's hard to say what the percentages are anymore, but for a long time it said they were about 85% of the population. 14% of the population were the mainlanders who mostly came over between 45 and 49 when the Kuomintang lost China to the communists. Ho, in fact, came over in 1949 when he was 2 years old. He was born in mainland China. However, he was raised in southern Taiwan. His father died when he was young. You see this in The Time to Live, The Time to Die. His father died when he was young. And therefore, Ho had more time to spend out in the streets. And in the streets in southern Taiwan, everybody spoke Taiwanese. So he speaks perfect Taiwanese. As a matter of fact, he even speaks Mandarin with a very specific Taiwanese inflection. It's a very, very Taiwanese inflection. So, you know, as I explain to people, he's also Hakka. Yeah, that's a complicated issue. Hakka is another group. Yeah, most of the Hakka there predate 1945 as well. So he has this really interesting mix. He sort of touches all bases in Taiwan. He can sort of understand all of the various elements there. So. Just that fact alone, people are always surprised to find out that he is, in fact, a mainlander. Nevertheless, just the way he speaks, his primary focus on Taiwan, his willingness to use so much Taiwanese in his films, many people considered him in the 80s a real hero. This was a guy who actually used Taiwanese. For example, the film that you saw them watching outdoors, that was a healthy realist film from 1965 called Beautiful Duckling. And you see all the ducks going across the bridge. It's a very kind of unforgettable scene. Well, that was about, what was interesting about that trend, that was a trend that started in the 60s. It was only about life in Taiwan. It was not about retaking Taiwan. However, everybody in those films spoke Mandarin, perfect Mandarin. It was just perfect Mandarin. That was the thing that was very unrealistic.
So the schools too, the Mandarin was Mandarin.
Well, yes. You know, in talking about what they did with the language, it was at first an education policy. There was a trend in the 50s and the early 60s, a lot of films in the Taiwanese dialect. The Kuomintang was okay with that, so long as it didn't have any communist elements, it didn't go against it. They realized a lot of the older people were never going to learn Mandarin, so they said, that's okay, let these films be made. What they focused on initially was education. My wife talked to me a lot about this. When she went to school, if she spoke a word of Taiwanese, she would get fined. And fines, and you get slapped on the wrist with the sticks, and it would really, really hurt. Fines back then were a real issue. Her mother was very upset about this all the time because they just didn't have the money back then that they have today. They were really, really quite poor back then. So to have to be fined every time you speak Taiwanese, they really wanted to squelch it in the young people. they were hoping that the Taiwanese dialect would slowly die away. So the very fact that a film like this got made showed that they really, the system was now allowing the Taiwanese dialect to slowly come back.
To the gentleman's question, though, could you say something more generally about how the whole new cinema movement, it's a very complicated thing, obviously, but how the whole new cinema movement played a role in the liberalization process after the ending of martial law?
It's hard to say how much of a role cinema played in the ending of martial law. I would say it had very little impact on the ending of martial law. And the reason is because these films are not widely seen by the domestic audiences. The 80s, the Taiwanese described the 80s as our 60s, okay? We have the 60s with all the social tumult, all the protests. There were just protests after protests after protests in the 80s. The system was coming apart at the seams. John Jingguo was a very smart man. He was not like his father. He was not obsessed with retaking Taiwan. He realized we are in Taiwan to stay. This is it. We got to develop Taiwan. He had very intelligent economic policies that allows Taiwan to survive to this day because of that, because of all the development he allowed to happen in Taiwan. And he realized, I have to let Taiwanese into the KMT party. The fact is, what was really happening in the 80s is the Taiwanese were taking over the KMT. They were taking over the KMT. It was a revolution from within. It was a revolution within the system, because when John Jingguo passes away in 1988, the new president, Lee Dunhui, is in fact of Taiwanese origin. He spoke Mandarin very poorly. He spoke Japanese very fluently because he went to school under the Japanese, and he spoke Taiwanese. And he was the one, even though he was the head of the KMT, he was the one who pushed Taiwan to the brink of independence in the 1990s. And he was the one that the mainland government had the most trouble with. And he's a very controversial figure to this day in Taiwan, because some people think he took too many risks in pushing Taiwan to the brink of independence.
Now, you had a question. The second part of your question was about contemporary Taiwanese cinema. And we should come to that question. But I would like to ask a slightly more difficult question. Is the kind of project represented by Ho and the Taiwanese New Cinema sustainable as an aesthetic project in cinema? And I think of this because most film movements that develop this kind of momentum don't really usually last more than 5 or 6 years. And this is true from the Soviet cinema to neorealism. It's certainly true of the fifth generation in the mainland. But I don't really know if I've ever asked this question or heard it answered with respect to the Taiwanese cinema.
Well, that does sort of relate to his question, because what's happening in Taiwan right now, maybe you want to answer that first. I think you should.
I don't have intimate knowledge of today's Taiwanese cinema. I follow it occasionally and casually, but I don't really have a wide, comprehensive viewing of it. I guess I would say this. Across film history, there does seem to be this pattern. I don't want to make it seem like an eternal return. But when you have a sudden efflorescence of a movement, as Bart says, it doesn't last very long. But since World War II, we find a kind of cycle that you can find, I think, in European cinema and American cinema and elsewhere, where a movement reacting against a very strong commercial cinema, all Taiwanese popular cinema wasn't maybe completely strong, but it was pretty strong, reacting against it and turning to a kind of realism, a kind of self-conscious back to the roots. We're going to show ordinary people, be it in the city, in the country, in work, or play. We're just going to return to ordinary people. A certain number of directors really nourish that aesthetic. And then at a certain point, they become quite accomplished directors. And they turn more inward. They turn more to the problems of themselves or their associates or whatever. And then eventually they become sort of freed from their national context and float up as kind of world directors, if there's like a world music, a world cinema. And I see this happening again and again. Neorealism, I think, was the beginning or the clearest profile of this kind of pattern, where you have, let's get away from the conventions of popular cinema, so-called white telephone films, big spectacle films, and go to look at ordinary people, working class life. But then the directors who become very skillful at that and get reputations on the base of it then become much more distinctive, auteurs, they become less identified with that movement, and then that comes to the point when people say, well, there actually wasn't a movement. These people really weren't that unified. And then they become famous, and then they make international films. They're not even tied necessarily to their national culture. It happens with neorealism. I think you can argue it happens with the French New Wave. I think you can argue that it happens with the Iranian cinema. It has happened with the Iranian cinema. And I think it may have happened with the Taiwanese cinema. I'm no expert on Taiwanese cinema, but my guess is it played through some of those same trends. And now you have directors like Ho, who makes a film in Japan, makes a film in France. You know, now he can make a film on the mainland, but with European money. I mean, suddenly they're world filmmakers, and they may retain some ties to their local culture, but they're also part of a different system, the system that's promoted, as Bart and Jim have said, by a kind of festival culture, which is an overlay of a distribution system, another industrial system laid on, which essentially is Hollywood cinema, if you like. I mean, that's the only worldwide distribution system to really take off. That this second cinema, this art house, festival-driven specialty cinema, makes room for these distinctive auteurs according to its own social conventions. So in a way, I would say very roughly and sketchily, and on the basis of more guesswork than actual deep knowledge, that may be happening with Taiwanese cinema too.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. There's a couple points here. First of all, I try to imagine Ho's career if film festivals didn't exist. And I can't imagine how his career would have gone much beyond the 80s. He wouldn't have continued making the sort of films that he did if he didn't have that particular outlet. And I like to point that out because I've read a lot on the literature about film festivals for my current project. People are always complaining about what film festivals do wrong. Everybody complains about what they do wrong. But I think people have to admit what they also do right. And they do provide an outlet for a very different sort of cinema. But this very institution right here is an example of this. Toronto is arguably one of the most important. It's the most important in North America, no doubt about that. And it's very important for allowing these filmmakers to continue their careers to do these things, to provide people who don't want to just go to a multiplex and see the next highly kinetic fair during the summer. There's nothing wrong with watching that, but there is something wrong if that's all we can see. And I think that's the way they're sustained. Now, the other point about Taiwan that's interesting, I always say the Taiwanese new cinema began in 1982 roughly. It ended in 1987 rather definitively. And the reason I say that is because all the filmmakers and other people involved with the movement put out a joint statement early in 1987 saying, the system has to change. We need to make room for another kind of cinema. And that was the last time that group was really together. After that, most of the directors in the new cinema no longer made any more films. Only a handful of them did. The only two that really continued to be of renown were Hou Hsiao-hsien and Edward Yang. They continue to have these international, they become a part of this global film culture, this festival culture. Ho is still part of that to this day. Other people prefer to say, no, the new cinema continued. The new cinema still exists today because we still see these various traits of this. I don't quite agree with that view because I think there's just been too many changes. The most notable change in roughly the last 5 years or so are these commercial films that the gentleman over here was asking about. This is a really new trend in Taiwan because the commercial cinema in the 1990s was virtually extinct. There was no real commercial cinema left. And Hong Kong had also declined very significantly. Taiwan, in fact, became the most dominated market in terms of Hollywood films in all of Asia. There were complicated reasons for that. The government completely opened the market to Hollywood in exchange for being allowed into the WTO. That is a direct result of Taiwan's very ambiguous diplomatic status. So they made the film industry completely a sacrificial lamb for Hollywood. That's essentially what happened. So suddenly there are a few directors who are now making more commercial fare. Most of all, Cape Number 7, which was a very I find it a very odd film. It has a lot of music thrown in it. It has a lot of Taiwanese and Mandarin mixed together. But it's not at all like the new cinema. It's a very commercial film. And that allowed the director to then make a very expensive film for $25 million, now the record, a film about an Aboriginal uprising against the Japanese in the 1930s called Siddiq Ballet. And that film...
In English, Warriors of the Rainbow.
Right, thank you. It's a film that actually was entered in the competition at Venice. It did not win. It's not the sort of film that's going to win a competition at the film festival. It's a very bloody, very highly charged action film. In some ways, impressive film. The problem is that it despite the fact that they used the money from Cape Number 7, which is a big unexpected box office hit to make this film, $25 million, they did not make that $25 million back. And one person I talked to who had worked in the government and then worked in the National Film Archives, he says that case just shows you that none of our problems have been solved. We're in the same position we've always been. We always have these one-off successes. 10 years earlier, it would have been Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, but that wasn't even a Taiwanese film. That was really a multinational co-production. It was primarily Hollywood might behind it that made Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. It just happened to be An Lee is from Taiwan that is directing it, that he decided to call it a Taiwanese film when it entered the foreign picture competition at the Oscars. So yes, there is a small, minor trend of commercial films being made now. I think some of the low-budget ones probably make some money, or a little bit of money at least, but there is no system in place to have a really sustainable popular film industry. That requires a sort of policy that was done in Korea, where the government got very, very heavily involved, worked with the private sector to set up a system that protected the industry enough to have an indigenous industry, to come up with good production strategies that made films that people in Korea actually wanted to see, and actually throughout Asia wanted to see. Korea is a model that many people in Taiwan say, if Korea can do it, why can't we? That's what they say in Taiwan. Well, the reason is pretty clear. The government in Taiwan pays lip service to helping the film industry, but it really does nothing to help the film industry. That's exactly why Taiwan is still not like Korea is.
Now, that seems to be a resounding way in which to finish our discussion, if that's okay with everyone. I'd like to thank James Udden and David Bordwell for their amazingly detailed and forceful answers. And thank you very much for coming. I would like to say that films by Edward Yang, as well as further films by Hou Hsiao-hsien, will be shown as part of the Chinese cinema, Century of Chinese Cinema, including the Terrorizers and Brighter Summer Day. Right, Time to Live, Time to Die, and City of Sadness will be shown back to back on the 10th. Thank you very much for coming.